right now. The text will be coming from Matthew chapter 14, verse 1 to 12. And that text is the account regarding the birthday of Herod. Okay, the birthday of Herod and the beheading of John the Baptist. Sipin niyo yun? Herod's birthday, John's beheading. Okay, something like that. So there are two occasions that happen from this text. One is an occasion to rejoice, and the other one is an occasion to mourn. Nakita niyo yung parallelism ng dalawa? Napansin niyo? Herod's birthday versus John's beheading. If you're going to celebrate or be reminded of a certain experience, what would it be? Would it be your birthday or would it be your beheading? Ano mas gusto mo, birthday or beheading?
The birthday.
Birthday na lang. Birthday na lang. Okay, so ang Bible ay natawa ako sa kwento ng isang nagbibirong pastor. One pastor told the story. It was Herod's birthday. And then, when the platter with the head of John the Baptist was brought, okay, before the king suddenly heard a hissing sound. Where's that sound coming from? They were wondering. Where is that sound coming from? Of course, it's just a joke, okay? And then, when Herod was about to see the face or the head of John the Baptist, he opened the cover of the platter. And then, immediately, John the Baptist's eyes opened. And he said, "Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday to you!" Okay, so kinatahan ba naman ni John the Baptist? Grabing at taba ng utak ng pastor na ito. Kakaiba. Okay, now that's of course is a joke, but this one is real and it's really very very serious, and it will answer our question that is presented here from the screen. How can we show perseverance and real trust in God? Because that's what we're going to talk about tonight. So let's bow down our heads as we now open in prayer. Lord, we thank you for another freedom, another opportunity you're giving us, and we're going to listen to the preaching of your word. And I pray, God, that you touch our hearts, Lord. Illumine our minds. Change our lives, Lord. And let your word minister to us that which it purposes. Lord, we thank you because we are free to do this, Lord, and nothing and nobody is hindering us, and we're just so grateful because things like this are things of utmost importance to us. Thank you, Father. Teach us, Lord, as we open up our minds, as we open up our hearts, Lord. May we receive your word in majesty and power, with much illumination and blessing upon each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say?
Amen.
Okay. So how can we show perseverance and real trust in God? In verse 1, can you see the verse? Oh, is it moving? Okay. That's the introductory verse. Why don't we read it all together? At the time, Herod the Tetrarch heard of the fame of Jesus, and said unto his servants, "This is John the Baptist. He is risen from the dead, and therefore mighty works do shew forth themselves in him." We can see from here that although Jesus was never preaching a confusing message, he is clear as far as himself is concerned. But even though that is what Jesus did, okay, still many people, particularly Herod, is so confused. Herod said to his servants, "This is John the Baptist. He is risen from the dead." Okay, this was after John the Baptist was beheaded. And then he thought that Jesus was able to perform all those miracles because the power of John the Baptist was upon him. But I cannot agree to that because not one statement in Scripture that it says that John the Baptist performed miracles, healing, signs, and wonders. Tama ba ako? Am I right? Not one occasion, not one instance. Now, why is Herod so confused here? Okay, I figured out that we as Christians, we have to spread the gospel truth of Christ correctly. Okay, we have to see to it that whenever we share the gospel, it has to be very, very crystal clear. Why? Because many people, although you are presenting to them already the truth, you are already presenting them the exact words that they need to hear, but still some people are so dumb and numb and they just can't get it. Okay, there will always be confusion. What more, if you present an untruth or a lie or something that is not in line with the with the principal teachings of the Bible. So we have to be exact, we have to be accurate in our teaching as we present the gospel truth of Christ, and we have to do it the right way. So, you see, in the midst of all those confusions, still there are problems that comes along. Okay, and what are those problems? Okay, now this is the first point. The answer to the question, how can we show perseverance and real trust in God? Okay, does it move? Okay, ano sabi dyan? Sacrifice by enduring grave persecutions. Okay, let's read verse 3. For Herod has laid hold on John and bound him and put him in prison for Herodias' sake, his brother's Philip's wife. Okay. Now, with regards to perseverance and trust, if you want to show that, you have to be able to sacrifice by enduring grave persecutions. Now, as you read along that verse, it's very obvious already that John himself suffered from the hands of Herod. He was bound, he was laid hold on, he was placed or put into prison because of a certain issue, and it is an issue with regards to Herodias. Okay, who is Herodias? It says here, brother Philip's wife. Now, for you to get a better grasp or understanding of what the problem is, now this is the explanation of our pastor and mentor John MacArthur. Okay, I want everyone to read, and when you read it with much understanding, so you can get it automatically. Let's go. Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. Herodias was the daughter of Aristobulus, another son of Herod the Great. So when she married Philip, she was marrying her own father's brother. Imagine, her own father's brother. What precipitated the arrest of John the Baptist was that Herod Antipas, another of Herodias' uncles, talked Herodias into leaving her husband, his brother, in order to marry him. Thus, compounding the incest, as well as what? As violating Leviticus 18:16. John was outraged that a ruler in Israel would commit such a sin openly. So he rebuked Herod severely. For this, he was imprisoned and later killed. Okay, do I need to say more about that? So, John was dealing with the sin of incest here, okay, which is, of course, a very dark sin. It's extremely wicked and shockingly vile, and it is also depravedly evil. So, that's how dark this sin is. That's why John rebuked Herod, even in the face of a severe trial or persecution, as that of bounding him and putting him into prison. So the question is, are we willing to sacrifice by enduring great persecution? Are we able to fight off persecution by enduring them. So if you have a ringing testimony of Christ in your life and you're telling other people about Him, it would be inevitable for you that you will be persecuted. But if you're just silent, okay, you do not tell anything to your neighbor, you don't say anything about Christ, then of course you will not be persecuted. You understand? You will not be persecuted because people aren't hearing anything from you anyway. So why should they bother to persecute you? But if you're giving a ringing or a loudly sounding testimony of Christ to other people and you are also rebuking them for their sins, now I'm sure persecutions will come in. And sometimes you have to endure them. Sometimes they will be grave enough that it will require sacrifice on your part. Amen?
Yeah.
Okay, now, sometimes we are weakened by persecutions, by doubts and intrigues, just like what I told you last week. But sometimes we have problems and that also makes us weak. It says in the next slide, kahit sobrang lakas ng immune system mo, pag wala kang pera, manghihina ka. Okay? What does that say? No matter how strong your immune system is, if you don't have money, you will definitely become weak. Ako manghihina naman talaga. Okay. Pastor, why did you give us that illustration? It's because we have to bear within ourselves a strong mind, a strong heart, in order for us to endure great persecutions if ever they come. Okay. Most of the time, our problems are but monetary or financial. Is that the truth? Totoo naman, di ba? Puro pera-pera lang problema natin. Okay. Pero, mga kapatid, if we come to the point when you will be persecuted, you will be attacked by other people, and then your lives will be placed in a certain danger because of you having a ringing testimony of Christ. Now, you have to strengthen your heart at the time. So, be ready, brothers and sisters. If you must sacrifice by enduring great persecutions, prepare yourself. Everybody say?
Amen.
The next point is, share the truth. That hurts those concerned. Okay, let's read all together the verse. For Herod had laid hold on John and bound him and put him in prison for Herodias' sake, his brother Philip's wife. For John said unto him, it is not lawful for thee to have her. Okay, John was so straightforward in his statement against Herod. He said, it is not lawful for you to have her. You should not be married to this man. That is incest. It's a very dark sin that you have to repent from. Okay? Talagang siguro sa tapang ni Juan, talagang may picture niya. Ay, hindi mo pala dinuturo. Akala ko dinuturo. At least pwede sasabihan. Okay? But it is very clear from Herod that it was him that is being referred to by John as doing this certain sin and nobody else. Okay? Now, we have to share the truth that hurts those concerned, if we must. So that's why we always present a gospel with the message of repentance and not merely believing. We do not present a social gospel, we do not present a prosperity gospel, but what we rather present is the Jesus gospel, the gospel with repentance.
Yeah.
Amen. Okay. Some people are sharing the gospel this way. Hey, you know, if you believe in Jesus Christ, your sins will be forgiven. He will accept you as you are. Huh? And you can just go on with your life as long as you have Jesus as your Lord. But there's no mention about repentance. Okay. Whenever we preach the gospel, it was said, A gospel without the message of repentance is no gospel at all. It is not the true gospel. Okay, that's why whenever we talk to other people, we make mention of sins. We make mentions of the dangers of hell and punishment and of judgment. These things should always be mentioned whenever the gospel is presented. But if you're only presenting the gospel with the promise of prosperity, of healing, you know, and blessing, many churches are like that nowadays. If you want to be popular, brothers and sisters, you preach happiness and blessing. If you want to be popular, but if you want to be unpopular, you preach holiness. Say amen.
Amen.
So, part of our message is the message of repentance. It says here by John MacArthur, the more like Christ you are, let's read it. The more like Christ you are, the more the world will treat you like they treated Christ. Maybe you don't get much persecution because there's not much similarity. How sad. How sad. If we don't receive any persecution, maybe because they're seeing us as someone who is not at all different from them. Dapat iba tayo eh. Dapat may napapansin silang changes in our lives. They should be able to see that we are creating an impact and making a difference in our lives, even in the eyes of other people. And we have to really desire to be more like Christ. So, if you are like Christ, then the world will treat you the way Christ was treated by the world. Ganun talaga yun eh. So, let's just stand in our, let us share the truth that hurts those concerned, even though they will become angry. Okay. You have to tell them the truth. Although it is not comfortable on their part. Who among you here has a best friend? Meron kayong best friend? Meron ka? Yung kayo, wala kayong best friend? Meron kayong best friend? O asawa nyo lang? Or mahal nyo lang? Okay. I have a best friend and I am able to tell anything to this person even if my words would hurt him much. And whenever I hurt him with my words, because I am a preacher of righteousness, and if I see anything wrong with his life or lifestyle, then I talk about it freely and openly. And then I tell him, hey, this is what you should be doing, and this is what you should not be doing. Amen. And so it hurts him. And so I always tell him, hey, I can tell you any words that might even hurt you. Even hurt you so much because I am your friend. If I'm not your friend, then I won't bother telling you these things. Hindi ko na kailangan sabihin sa'yo ito kasi hindi mo kita kaibigan. Kaya malakas ang loob kong sabihin sa'yo kahit masakit dahil kaibigan kita. Tama ba ako mga kapatid?
Yeah.
Okay. I would like to have that applied even in our church. Matagal na tayong nagkakasama rito. We've been together for a very long time. Sometimes you will be hearing your pastor telling you words that hurt. Would that be okay on your part? If it's the truth, is it okay if you would hear from me hurting words? Words of rebuke? Words of correction? Is that okay? If it's okay with you, then would you raise your hand so I can see at least who can I talk to? While using hurting words, it's okay with you. Are you sure? Are you sure? Walang mura, syempre. Okay. So sometimes I would be, because I have to tell you the truth. I have to share the truth that even hurts those concerned. In line with that, brothers and sisters, is my fourth point. Okay, and it is quite a little related to the previous point. It says there, stand in your conviction without compromise. Okay, let's go and read the verse. And when they would have put him to death, he feared the multitude because they counted him as a prophet. But when Herod's birthday was kept, the daughter of Herodias danced before them and pleased Herod. Okay. So after John dealt with Herod, it was determined that John should die. He must be put to death. But Herod was quite fearful of the multitude because he knows that John is regarded by the people as God's prophet. And so he must not be treated that way. So that's why he was just imprisoned. He was not immediately sentenced to death. He was just bound. He's not even tortured, brothers and sisters. So an occasion happened. And so this started the problem. Ano yun? Verse 14, but when Herod's birthday was kept, the daughter of Herodias danced before them and pleased Herod. In the other gospel accounts, it was mentioned there that Herod was telling Salome, okay, the daughter of Herodias, to dance before them so that they will he would be pleased. Okay. But not only him, it would be more on his guests who are also watching him, watching her dance. You get the point? So he wants to please the visitors by having Herodias dance in that manner. Ang tawag dyan. Nag-agogo na.
Belly dancing.
Nag-belly dancing na.
Okay.
And there are so many people like here in Pattaya. Dito sa Pattaya, daming ganyan. Okay? So it was a, what kind of dance is that? No, that, I mean, it's a sexy dance. Another term for that? Erotic dance. Okay, and so it would please any man who would watch her, of course. And then, in the other account, it was said that Herod promised Herodias and Salome that whatever they would wish, he's willing to give them even half of his kingdom. Imagine that. He was willing enough to share even half of his kingdom if only Herodias or Salome would give in to the whims of Herod. Okay. Now, the point is, brothers and sisters, without compromise, you should be able to stand in your conviction. If it would cost you your life, if it would cost you to be imprisoned or bound or pay big sums of money or suffer a penalty or maybe suffer a persecution, your conviction should remain standing and you should never compromise, brothers and sisters. There is another explanation of John the Baptist about Salome. Okay, I want everybody to read that aloud. Let's go. The daughter of Herodias, Salome, daughter of Herodias and Philip. According to Josephus, the Jewish historian, she married yet another son, her own father's brother and her mother's uncle, of Herod the Great, thus further tangling the web of incest in that family. Okay, I tried understanding those. However, I tried to understand it, the more I get confused. Because I'm so poor in with regards to relationships or, descendancies, lineages, or who is the son of who is the mother of this and that. It's quite confusing. Even if you read that slowly in your mind, you would not immediately get it. But in summation or in a summary, what's happening on here is but another case of incest. So, Herodias was married to Herod. That is a case of incest. And then again, this Salome is also what? A case of incest is involved, or maybe the parents of Salome themselves are also incestuous. So it is quite alarming. It is actually a scandal. I believe it was known by many people during their time. Okay, it was known. Why? Well, John the Baptist himself was able to learn of their situation. And that's why he was the number one antagonist to Herod. And he was the number one person who was dealing with him. Okay, he understood. Okay? Hindi na chismis yan. Talagang ano na. It's not gossip. It's a real factual story and a knowledge common to many people that it was brought to the ears of John. And so John did something to rebuke them. Why? Because he is standing in his conviction without any compromise. Now look at the next picture, brothers and sisters. And from there, you will see the relationship of this picture to the point that I have just given you. You see that? It's about the Statue of Liberty. It was made with what? With copper. But due to oxidation, it changed to green. Meaning to say, the original color of this statue was that copper. Copper, parang brown na orange yan, di ba? So, what caused the changing of the color? Oxidation. What is oxidation? I don't know. I haven't researched that, but there has something to do perhaps with the water. With the wherever the statue is standing, there is water that surrounds it, you know. And because of the heat of the sun, and then so gases are filling the air, and so those gases made such a chemical reaction to the copper that it turned into green. And we know that copper, usually when it rusts, it turns to green. That's why the Statue of Liberty became green. Okay. Now, what is your point here, Pastor? Why is this illustration? It means to say, just like the Statue of Liberty is standing tight, okay, without any movement. Okay, it did not move, but it changed its color. In the same way, you have to stand on your ground, stand in the faith. No matter what is ongoing around you, whatever is happening in your world or within your sphere of influence, though people may be attacking you, still you have to stand your ground. Kahit iba na ang tingin sa iyo ng ibang tao, mag-iba ka ng kulay, kahit mali na yung pananaw nila sa iyo, even if you if people would think you of something else other than your real person, as long as you stand your ground and you don't compromise, then you have done a good job. Ganun lang yun, mga kapatid. So stand in your conviction without compromise. Huwag kang magbabago, huwag kang susuko, huwag kang magpapalit ng paninindigan mo. Kahit ibang tao na ay tumitira sa iyo at mali-mali na kailang mga sinasabi. Kahit iba ka na sa pananaw nila, ang mahalaga, sumusunod ka sa Panginoon. Amen? Amen. The important thing is you're following Christ no matter how people perceive who you are. They think differently. They think you are an oddball, you're a strange person, you're a person who's crazy. And why all this Christ? Why all this Bible? But you just stand your ground and be firm in your conviction and don't ever compromise. Everybody say, Amen, Amen. Maganda yung discussion ko niyan eh. So, in my next point, how can we show perseverance and real trust in God? We're doing all this, brothers and sisters, as we trust in the Lord. Okay? We do not rely on our own strength. We don't have any powers of our own to be able to persevere. It is simply because God is also preserving you. God is enabling you to live the Christian life in a way that it will please God. The Christian life is not difficult. Okay? It is impossible, Bill Bright said.
Why is it impossible? Because you cannot live the Christian life your way. It takes the intervention and the work of God in your life before you can ever walk the Christian life. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Kilusta Diyos yun eh. It's impossible on your part. So you have to rely on the mercies of God, depend on His grace, and see to it that you are holding on to the basic faith that you have as long as you don't compromise and you continuously stand in your conviction. The next point, show your dependence on God's sovereignty. Okay, why don't you read the verse? Ang dami yan eh. Okay, let's go. Whereupon he promised with an oath to give her whatsoever she would ask. And she, being before instructed of her mother, said, "Give me here John the Baptist's head in a charger." And while the king was sorry, nevertheless for the oath's sake, and them which sat with him at meat, he commanded it be given her. And he sent and beheaded John in the prison. And his head was brought in a charger and given to the damsel, and she brought it to her mother. It's a very, very sad story on this part of the verse. Before Salome danced, she and her mother talked to each other. And maybe after Herod promised Salome, "I will give you whatsoever you ask." And so Salome turned to her mother, "Mom, what will I ask of him? What will I ask? Ano hingin ko sa kanya?" And so Herodias silently told Salome, "Okay, I want the head of John the Baptist. It has to be brought in a charger, in a platter. Not the charger of your cell phone, huh?" Hindi charger ng cell phone. It's a platter. It's a big metal plate or what? O ano man yan. Okay. And so, until Herod has no choice but to give in to the wish of the mother and the daughter. He felt so sorry about what he said. And the king was sorry, nevertheless, for the oath's sake. He has to fulfill his vows. He promised that I would even give you half of my kingdom. And if he will not be following his word, hindi niya susundin yung kanyang sinabi, it would be an embarrassment not only to Herodias and Salome, but even to his friends who were invited during his birthday party. Okay? So it would be a disgrace on Herod's part if he would not be giving in to the wishes of the mother and the daughter, Herodias and Salome. So the birthday would become a disgrace. Ang Tagalog na disgrace?
Disgrace.
Kahiyan. Okay. Kahiyan. Birthday, kahiyan. Diba? Birthdays are supposed to be a time of merriment and an occasion to be joyful for. But if that would happen, then that would be an utter embarrassment on Herod's part. Okay? Who among you here loves birthdays too much? You like birthdays? Raise your hand if you like birthdays.
Own birthday or others' birthday?
Own or others' birthdays? There will be people who will be celebrating birthdays this September.
Alam
mo na yun. Okay. And Brother Anouk, there's someone celebrating your birthday this September. Nobody. On October, right? Now he's denying. Okay, so show your dependency on God's sovereignty. What happened here is that since Herod has no other choice but to give in to the wishes of the mother and the daughter, and so John was beheaded in the prison. Look at the next picture. The gruesome beheading of John the Baptizer. Baptizer is a better term than Baptist, probably. Okay, and you can see that from the first picture below, Ayan, and then in the second picture, the head is already cut off and placed on a charger or platter.
Charger?
Oh, charger yung ginamit na English yun. Uh-huh. Ano yung re-recharge? Okay, so ayan. And then there is, I think that is Herodias or Salome, wherever that lady is. But I'm sure they're very glad about it. Why? Because nobody will anymore tell them with regards to their sin of incest and adultery. Now, show your dependence on God's sovereignty. Whatever happens, okay, whatever will be, sabi nga nila. Ano yung kantang yun? Kesera sera. Kesera sera. Whatever will be. Ano yung kasunod lang?
Let it be.
Let it be. Let it be. Naging, ano? Naging bitter sa... Okay. Eh, ganun talaga eh. There are things in life that will inevitably happen to you because you are not at all in control of every situation. It is only God who holds all things. If it's your time to die, it's your time to go. If it's your, if it's already your time to get out from Thailand, well, it's that time. I believe so. If it's your time to die, you will die. So, with regards to dying, there's no such thing as accident. Okay, why did he die early? Well, that's his appointed time. The Bible says, in Hebrews 9:27, for it is appointed unto man to die once, and after that is the judgment. So even our death is our appointment. Okay? Would you like to have an appointment with God? Raise your hand. Of course, nobody wants. Okay? So, even if you desire, even if you desire, it's still not your time. It will still linger on. Tatagal pa nga lalo. There are some people who wants to die, but they don't die. And there are some people who wants to live, but they die early. You get my point? So if it's your time to go, it's your time to go. Well, Esther said, if I perish, then I perish. It will be coming to a point when all of us would be persecuted, and maybe we are attacked by what's that person that brings in bomb in his body? A suicide bomber? Okay. So if that happens here, well, we cannot do anything about it. Because it's our time to go. So, show your dependence on God's sovereignty. Why? Because He is God, He is sovereign, He will do whatsoever He pleases. Nothing happens by accident. And God's timing are always perfect. And whatever God decides in our lives, we have no choice but to submit to Him. Amen? Whatever is going on in your life right now, you're having such kinds of difficulty, let me tell you an encouraging word. Hey, it's because God has better plans than your plans. Amen? Okay? God is in control of your life. God knows what is best for you. Okay, and whatever is happening, it's part also of His training. Kasama yan eh. Kaya yung ating ano, yung mga experiences natin, training yan, training yan. Don't be bitter about your training. You just show your dependence on God's sovereignty. Whatever happens, it will happen. But I'm sure God's hand is there. Okay. Now, another, may nakuha tayo sa picture dyan. Ayan, pangalawa. You see that? Okay. So he's dead. But he's not singing happy birthday to Herod. Walang ganun. Okay. So, have you watched a video of beheading? Have you watched? Have you seen? I did. Who else? Did not? You did already? It's so gruesome, so bloody, you know? Would you like me to tell you something about it? How you would feel if you are beheaded? Imagine a thick knife slitting your throat and you're writing in pain, and then you're hurting too much, and you can no longer be. You can just imagine. It's so torturous.
What about the plastic knife?
So, you see, that's what Herod experienced. If you watch a beheading video, then you'll get a more vivid picture of what happened to this person. If ISIS would come here and raid us and then behead each one of us here, who would like to go first? Would like to go first? I would go first. Because it would be more torturous in my mind if I watch any one of you being beheaded right in front of me. I would go first. Now, who wants to be next? Rachel, you want to be next? After him, who will be next? Come on! After Jerry, who's next? Come on! Okay. We'll remember the sequence or the order. Who's next after Jerry? Come on.
Pastor,
And then they will ask. Whoever person here wants to renounce Christ, get out of this room now. Now who would go out?
Peter.
Who would go out? Will you go out or will you stay?
Huh?
Okay, Alinda, I'll go to the bathroom. Oh, I forgot something in my house. I'll just go back. You see? There's even much more persecution in Pakistan than in the Philippines. Am I right? You think so? But there are also persecution in Mindanao.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Could be the same as in Pakistan. Okay, and we're so blessed that we are in a country like this where there is freedom and we're not being persecuted in that manner. So you just show your dependency on God's sovereignty because you will never know what will happen next. And be calm in your spirit and be able to hold on to the promises of God that whatever happens, God is in control anyway. Everybody say it. Amen. 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 And then now my last point is signify commitment to our suffering brethren. Okay, you have to signify. You show your commitment to our suffering brethren. What happened? It says there, and his disciples came and took up the body and buried it and went and told Jesus. So there are so many verses there. Came, took up the body, buried, went, and told. So those are all words that signify commitment to John the Baptist. Most especially his followers or people who has believed his message and the message of Christ. I believe that after John the Baptist was put into prison, of course their leader is already gone, and so the devotion, the loyalty of these people who were former followers of John the Baptist, they turned into Christ. Because John the Baptist was always pointing people to Christ. So you don't need to follow me. You follow him. I must decrease. He must increase. So you put your faith on him, not on me. And so, upon learning that John was beheaded, he already died, he was killed. And so they took up the body and paid their last respects by giving him a proper or decent burial. And then it says there, they went and told Jesus about it. And we know that Jesus felt sad about the news. Okay, so in the same way, brothers and sisters, let's signify our commitment to our suffering brethren. We have brethren here who are suffering. If ever you are in need of something, feel free to enunciate, feel free to tell us whatever your your difficulties are, we may be able to help. Because everybody here is willing to help. Everyone who is willing to help, will you raise your hand? Come on, raise your hand if you are willing to help at any form, at any time, at any rate. Okay. You look around. So when you need money, you know who to turn to. Okay? How much do you need? Oh, I need 20 baht. Oh, I thought 2,000 baht. Okay, 20. You don't need to borrow, I'll just give it to you. That's just a very simple, pathetic way of saying how we can signify our commitment to our suffering brethren. There's this one person, and then the pastor told this person that you have to bring your problem to the church. Okay, bring your problems to the church, and this is what he did. The pastor asked them to bring their problems to the church, and so this man brought his fire. So, Father Cos, if we have any problems like this, get ready with the big basic. Okay. Okay. Brother Eric, ikaw ba ang bubuhatin o si Sister Marisa bubuhatin? Who will be carried? You or Sister Marisa? Okay. Baka ito pa nga yung buhati ni Jeanette dito. Ito yung problema. Okay. Okay. Tatawa lang ako sa picture na yan. Okay. So if you have any problem, bring it to the Lord and I'm sure the Lord will respond to our needs. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. And of course, when somebody opens up and tells their problems to you, if you can lend or extend a helping hand, it would be best that you do. Because we are here, after all, to support one another. Everybody say, amen and amen. So, in summary of our sermon for tonight, with the title, Perseverance and Trust, in answer to the question, how can we show perseverance and real trust in God? So these are the points. Why don't we read it all together? Sacrifice by enduring great persecutions. Share the truth that hurts those concerned. Stand in your conviction without compromise. Show your dependence on God's sovereignty and signify commitment to our suffering brethren. Lord, we thank you for this message tonight. Continue, Lord, to touch our hearts that we may be able to give a proper response, that we may truly live with perseverance and trust in you. God, I pray, help us to be able to sacrifice by enduring grave persecution. If we must undergo such trials, Lord, prepare our hearts. Help us, Lord, to share the truth that even hurts those concerned. Help us, Lord, to be bold in our sharing of the gospel. Help us, Lord, to be the light of the world, the salt of the earth, reminding people that they have to turn to Christ and even repent from their sins. Whenever our convictions are being challenged, help us, Lord, to stand by it without compromise. Help us, Lord, to show always our dependency on your sovereignty. After all, you are always in control. There are many things, Lord, in life that we have no control over with, but then, as we look to your grace, to your power, as we look to your mercies, we know that later on, we will be comforted. Thank you, Lord, for teaching us also to signify our commitment even to our suffering brethren. That whenever there is an opportunity for us to help other people, we pray, Lord, that our hearts will be open enough, willing to help, willing to share, willing to give. Thank you, Father, Lord, for you have taught us to continuously persevere, to continuously trust in you, in what you are about to do. And there's no other better thing that we can do but to trust and persevere. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, the song, we'll have one song and prepare your offerings while this is being sung. While this is being sung, from the first and second stanza, listen carefully, you will go forward and bring your offerings here, okay? So you're not going to bring your offerings after the song, but on the first and second stanza of the song. Are you ready? Okay? Okay, let's raise our offerings. Lord, we thank you for the way you bless us. And whatever we give tonight, Lord, is just an acknowledgement of your faithfulness, of the way you provided for us, Lord. And you showed us, Lord, how faithful you are in providing for all the needs that we have. Thank you, God. Please keep on giving, and we shall continually praise you and acknowledge you, even with the fruit of our substances. Thank you, Lord. We honor you in our giving tonight, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing.
It's so sweet to trust in.
Tayo po tayong lahat at magkaloob.
Just to take you at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know blessed the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust.
trust him more.
Lord, we thank you for the gathering of the offerings. I pray, Lord, that you bless all this money that will be used for your kingdom. And bless also the lives of those who have given. I pray, Lord, that you continuously meet all their needs, Lord. For we know that you shall supply all of them according to your riches and glory. We thank you also, Lord, for the sermon that we have heard tonight. And truly, Lord, our souls were fed by the word, and your word has encouraged us much, Lord, in order for us to keep trusting and to keep persevering. Let's lift up our hands and receive the pastoral benediction. Take good care to observe the commandments and instructions of the Lord that he has commanded you. That is to love the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to keep his commandments, and to hold fast to him, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. May God's love be upon you, may Christ's grace be upon you, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon you, both now and evermore, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Everybody say, Amen. Amen.